Thank you for joining us on this Vive Church podcast. If you're in the Northern California area or coming through anytime soon, we want to invite you to join us for our Easter experience on April 16th at one of our three locations, San Francisco, Palo Alto, or San Jose. There's six service options, as every campus has a 9:30 and 11:30 service. Now, we're currently in our amazing series, Church, Confronting the Human, and we believe this message is going to speak directly to you, so we hope you enjoy it.
For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, one who has been tempted in every way, yet he did not sin. In the rubble, ruin, from the rubble, redemption.
Such an honor to be able to bring the word around Palm Sunday, and I do have a word for you, but can I encourage you, next week he's back in the pulpit, and it's Easter Sunday, it's Resurrection Sunday, and it's your invitational week to get everybody you know, your work colleagues, your friends, your family, the people in your world. There is a world out there that needs Jesus, right? I don't know how people do life without Jesus. He's the thing that gets me through. He's the thing that brings perspective to this crazy, crazy life. And there's so much stuff going on out there. Let me tell you, my husband and I are committed to preaching the good news. So you're going to get a good message, a good news message today. Amen. And so I want to encourage you, invite. Make sure you're here early next week for your park and your seat as well, because we're going to pack this place out. But Luke chapter 19, verse 28. Oh, it says this. After telling this story, Jesus went on towards Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples. As he came to the towns of Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead. Go into the village over there, he told them. As you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks why are you untying the colt, just say the Lord needs it. So they went and found the colt, just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owners asked them, why are you untying the colt? And the disciples simply replied, the Lord needs it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it for him to ride on. As he rode along, the crowd spread out their garments on the road ahead of him. When he reached the place where the road started, down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. But some of the Pharisees among the crowd, and there's always Pharisees among every crowd, isn't there? They said, teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that. He replied, if they kept quiet, I tell you, the stones along the road would begin to burst into cheers. Why don't we pray this morning? Father, we just thank you for this word. I thank you that it's a word that's going to transform us from the inside out. Lord, would you bring praise into full perspective for us today? And everybody said, amen, amen. Well, why don't you high five someone in your campus, wherever you are, whoever you're sitting next to, take your seat. We're going to get ready to come around the word of God this morning. Thank you, amazing worship team. Who loves our worship teams? Our worship teams, we have them in every location. They're incredible. But let me tell you, I have entitled this message today for all my note takers, Praise in Perspective. Okay, praise in perspective. I tossed up with a few different titles, you know, the power of praise and all of that. And then I came up with praise in perspective. It's going to make sense to you later, okay? It'll be in perspective later. But you're going to help me preach today, aren't you, Palo Alto? Let me tell you, sometimes we need to put some things into perspective. Any mamas in the house? Oh, yes. Yes, you are. Okay. That is our job, I believe, as mothers, is to put everything into perspective. So when my children are running down the house screaming at me because a moth is chasing them, I gotta put some things into perspective. This moth is like an ugly butterfly. Why are we afraid of moths? You know, like, I don't understand it. Plus, you have Australian blood running in your veins. You survived for the first 5 years of your entire life in a country where everything and anything wants to eat you and kill you. You're gonna be okay. You know, and then, you know, there's other things like they'll come running down. They'll go, Mom, you didn't see the way she looked at me. Because, you know, the sisterly arguments that take place. I know they happen in your home or they happen to you as a child. But I have to sit down and be like, sweetheart, do looks kill? No, they don't. I think you're going to be okay. You know, it puts some things into perspective. Just, you know, one of my children, I wish it were all three of my children, but only one of my children has to be dropped dead gorgeous at any given moment. And, you know, so getting out of the house is really hard, all right? So we are at the door. We are trying to get out of the house. And her outfit is the most important thing in the entire world. And, you know, there's often times where I'm thinking in my head, you know, you wouldn't have these thoughts because you're holy and you're wonderful and you're kind and you're nice. But I'm thinking you're going to be one of those three words and it's not gorgeous. You're just going to be plain dead if you don't get down here in 3 seconds dressed with clothes on your back, amen? There's times as a wife, you got to put some things into perspective for your husband, right? You know when he's got that man cold? You know, ladies, when he's got that man cold, baby, you're not going to die. You're going to be okay. You're going to be fine. You know, there's times where I have to put my own thoughts into perspective all the time. The coffee grinder blew up and electrocuted me 2 days ago. I was like that nasty thing, you know, and I was so upset and devastated that the grinder died. And then I had this epiphany thought, well, I'm so glad that the grinder died and not me, you know, better it than me. So perspective is important to get things in perspective. I find that we need to get praise in perspective. Oh, let me tell you, we're living in a day and age where praise needs to be put back into its right place, into perspective. Because you know what we do? We are conditioned for praise. We are conditioned to make everything about ourselves. Oh, when we have our children, we praise them for everything, don't we? We give them an award and a medal just for participating. It's like, you're a winner because you played the game. No, you're not. You just participated, right? And so we praise and we condition our children for praise. Maybe you've been conditioned for praise. I'd say that most of us have been conditioned for praise, that we perform at a level that we will obtain praise for. You know, most of us will praise because of the culmination of something great that we've done or accomplished, you know? And so I find that when we do that, we condition even our teenagers. Our children get to teenage years, and when they're conditioned for praise and their peers start praising them for doing the wrong things, then we wonder why things got out of hand. And then when we get into our adult years and we're conditioned for praise, we put that filter on God and we go, God, my praise for you is going to wait until I see some results. My praise for you is going to be on the back end of me getting that job. It's going to be in the back end of me conceiving that baby or finding that home or young people. I know you've got that list, girls, of that husband. You know, there's like 101 things on that list that God's got to tick off, and you'll praise him when you finally get that guy, right? And so sometimes we've got to get praise and put it back into perspective. Do you know that we need to condition our children to praise. We need to condition ourselves to praise. Do you know that we were made to praise? Everything gets out of perspective when we shift the limelight and the glory onto ourselves. And so the importance of this today is so powerful in framing the way that God will work in your world. And so here we have this passage of scripture in Luke, and you've got the people, and the people are praising and they're glorifying him. They're lining the streets, and Jesus is entering in on that donkey. They're taking their cloaks off and they're throwing them in front of him. It's kind of like a Justin Bieber concert. Everyone's losing their clothes for Jesus. And he's going in all his glory and all his majesty, and they're crying out, long live the king, you know? It's this moment of praise. And do you know what I love about this moment of praise and these people is that Jesus hasn't even saved them yet. They had a pre-praise. They knew what it was to praise prior to the resurrection. They knew what it was to praise prior to any vindication. There's something about that. They had a pre-game. You know, I don't know about you, but it's easy to praise post-resurrection, right? It's easy to praise when the game is won. You know, everybody knows how to praise when the game is won, but do you have a pre-game to your Christian walk? Do you know how to pre-game that Christian walk that you have? That's going to be important. Right here, you know, I think about this all the time because I think about Pastor Vance, who loves basketball, and he's always praising, you know, his teams when they are winning. And then you got Pastor Adam Hahn in San Jose, and he likes to watch the Masters. So I don't know, watching golf is kind of like watching the grass grow, but that's kind of his thing, you know? And they know how to praise post something, but they also know how to have a pre-game. I see those guys praising all the time. But here, the significance of this Sunday is that it's Palm Sunday. And it's the Sunday, the same Sunday, that in 5 days' time, all those years ago, Jesus would meet the cross. You see, his eyes are fixed on Jerusalem in this moment. And he is headed in. Do you know, at that moment, that was the Passover. Everyone was coming in for the Passover. Do you know about the Exodus from Egypt? And the Israelites were set free. Well, they came together in that moment to remember the Passover and celebrate it. And so Jews from all over the Roman world were coming in to celebrate this Passover, the great Exodus, and remember it. And they're witnessing this wonderful moment of Jesus coming in all his authority and all his glory. Do you know, the fact that they were praising prior is awesome. There was a level of expectancy attached to that praise, but there was also some expectations. And you know, they were expecting him to come as a national leader. They were expecting him to come as a king that would lead the nation and return them to their former glory. But let me tell you, sometimes when we have a pregame, we come with the same level of expectancy, but also expectations that we place on God. I'll praise you when you do this, fill in the blank, you know? And so I find that in this moment, while their pre-praise is important and it's good, there's a greater level of perspective that is about to take place, because they are even blind in this moment to what Jesus is about to do. Because Jesus isn't coming to set up a political kingdom. He's coming to set up an eternal kingdom, which is cause for the greatest celebration of all. And so in this moment, they might not have had their praise in full perspective, but let me tell you, Jesus had their praise in full perspective. He had it in the God perspective of eternity. Might seem crazy right now for those people to be praising Jesus on that donkey before he's even gone to the cross to do anything to actually save them. He's done a few miracles. He's performed some tasks along the way. He's set a few people free, but the cross is the real power and the resurrection is the real power. Might seem crazy to be celebrating and praising right here, but on the eternal perspective, on the eternal scale, it makes perfect sense. You see, What I love about Jesus is that in this moment on that donkey, his eyes are fixed on Jerusalem. You know, he has so much of an eternal perspective that he still sees all the obstacles that he is going to have to face. He knows them and he looks at them with a sober approach. But the fact that he has perspective and an eternal perspective to see through and to see above and to see beyond is the very thing that will enable him to be prepared to go through the obstacles. And so I want to talk to you a little bit about preparation today. Can I do that? Turn to the person next to you and say, prepare. Because your praise is going to bring perspective. Praise has the ability to elevate you above your situation and your circumstance so that you don't see it from underneath, so that you see it from above. And then there's this perspective that motivates us to get prepared. And this is how Jesus got prepared. He says this in Luke chapter 19, verse 28. We read it before, but we're going to read it again. Excuse me. It says, after telling this story, Jesus went on towards Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples. As he came to the towns of Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead of him. How many did he send? Two. And he said, go into that village over there, he told them. As you enter it, you'll see a donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. Hang on a minute. Jesus doesn't want them to ask for it first. No, just take it. Just take it is what Jesus is saying. And he says, if anyone asks, why are you untying that colt? Just say, the Lord needs it. So they went and found the colt just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owners came and asked them, why are you untying that colt? I don't know about you, but do you just like laugh at some of the stories that are written in the Bible? Like I have such a comedic mind when I think about these things. They're tapping them on the shoulder. What are you doing with my donkey? You know? And the disciples simply reply, the Lord needs it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it and they rid for him to ride on. You know, I've heard of applejacking, which is something that happens around here. Do you know what that is? When you rob or illicitly steal an apple product from someone on the street, it's called applejacking, right? I'm up with the lingo. I'm down with the stuff. You know, yeah, passes Rob and Terry. I got it. And so I'm teaching you stuff right here. And so applejack, heard of applejacking, never heard of donkey jacking. You know, it's probably like carjacking, right? Because it's a form of, you know, transportation. That's exactly right. And so here is Jesus. And he's like, take the donkey. And if they ask you, just tell them it's because I need it. Could you imagine that? Just taking someone's cart, sorry, the Lord needs it, you know? And it's like, so he sets some things in place, right? He sends them on a mission. The mission is the donkey. And then he sets them up with a response so that when the mission comes into question, they will have a response. I got to tell you, a couple years ago, my husband and I went to Cancun for our anniversary trip. And it was fun. But I told you about the time we stole those bikes, right? Some of you are like, oh my gosh, the pastors steal? No. They were really ours, but we just took them. Anyways, the hotel assigns bikes to you, but they didn't have enough bikes for everybody. So we were waiting on these bikes for the longest time. If you know my husband, you know that his patience level is kind of not that great. Like it's great, but it could be greater. And then he's watching right now. I love you, sweetheart. And so he is getting like more and more upset every day that we haven't got these bikes that we paid for. Now, one day we leave the restaurant and it's quite a long walk to get all the way back to our apartment. And we were doing it every day. And so he's like, you know what? I'm going to get a bike. There's 100 white bikes standing outside, you know? And so he just seizes the moment. He takes the tag off the bike, throws it into the lake with the alligators to destroy the evidence. And then he just mounts the bike and then rides off into the sunset. And I am left with 100 bikes and looking very guilty. So I had only one thing to do, mount the bike and ride after him. And so we did, and we got the bikes back to our hotel room. And what I didn't tell you was the next morning we wake up And as we begin to walk down the stairs of our apartment, there's one of the hotel assistants is standing there and they're looking at the bike. And they're looking at the bike and wondering why it doesn't have a number. And then they look at Adam and me and they're like, you know, is there a reason why your bike doesn't have a number? I'm like, don't ask me, you know, because I'm going to tell the truth, right? And then Adam, he says, oh, you know what, mate? We've been asking for a bike. They must have just dropped that off for us while we were sleeping. And you know, I don't know why it doesn't have a number. You see, the moral of the story, people, is have a response. Have a response. You got to be prepared in this life. You got to have a response. And you see the disciples here, they're untying the donkey. They're on the mission of Jesus. And they're looking over their shoulder while they're untying the donkey. But they have a response that Jesus has prepared them with. He's put some words in their mouth. What are you going to do when you're on a mission to get your healing? And the enemy knocks on your shoulder and says, what are you doing untying that healing? Are you going to get the word out that God's put in you? Are you going to have a response to say? Let me give you one. If you're struggling with sickness today, Psalm 107:20 says he sent his word and healed them, snatching them from the door of death. Let me tell you, God's put some words in your mouth to help you untie some of the things that are part of your mission. Maybe you're here today and you're struggling with depression and you're trying to untie that healing of mental health for your life. Let me tell you, you've got a response that you can put in the face of the enemy today. It says Psalm 34:17, the righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from their troubles. You have a troubled mind, friend. God has the answer for you. Whatever it is that you're facing, whatever it is that is the mission of your life, God has given you some words to use as a response when you're going to need it. Let me tell you, a response is powerful. You might be sick right now, but you got to prepare for your healing so that you can get it there. You might be struggling with anxiety and depression right here, but you got to begin to prepare for that healing. Oh, let me tell you, you got to prepare. Sometimes we look at this stuff and we go, oh, that's just positive talk. Oh, that's just silly. I'd feel silly declaring this stuff over my life. No, that's called faith. Let me tell you, when the Israelites, when they ate the Passover meal, they sat and the Lord had said, I am going to set you free after multiple plagues, and they were still not free. They partook in the Passover meal and they had to slaughter a spotless lamb. They had to put the blood over the doorpost, and then that would save every firstborn child. And so all of Egypt didn't obey any of that because they weren't a part of God's people or God's plan, and they lost their firstborn. But in this moment, what we see is the Israelites, and they are eating the meal, but they're dressed to travel. That seems really crazy. Can't we get dressed later? No, because they were prepared in that moment that whenever God was going to set them free, they were going to be ready to get on foot and get going. You see, God has got so much for you that he needs you to prepare for. Prepare for. You see, the way out of your situation is to prepare for it. Because when you prepare, that's when you begin to position. And you see, it might have seemed silly all those years ago when my husband and I boarded a plane with our three little girls. We booked the Maple Tree Inn in Sunnyvale, people. Such a classy hotel. For 14 days, we didn't have a plan B, we had a plan A. After 14 days, we were going to be on the street. That is just crazy. We didn't know until we got here this side that you need a social security number and that you need a credit rating to find a place. But praise be to God that we did something in our ability to prepare ourselves for God to move us into the call of God and the future and the plan that he had for us, so that when he said go, we could go. 4 days in the country, we found our place. 4 days, she wanted someone to move in immediately. We were ready. We're your people. We'll give you cash and we will move in today. You see, you might be here, but God intends for you to be there. And the way that you get there is to prepare. And so many of us have thought that God's going to do all the work. God's not going to do all the work. He wants you to prepare. Touch a person next to you, say, prepare, prepare, prepare. You see, because when you prepare, it positions you. And the second thing we're going to do today is we're going to position. Because in this moment, by this time, Jesus was extremely well known. Most of the people had heard about him up to the point where he's riding this donkey into Jerusalem. And so Jesus was so much in preparation mode that he is positioned amongst the praise of the people in this moment. In fact, Zechariah 9:9 prophesied it for them so that they would be able to see it and know what was happening. And so it says, look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt. Let me tell you that Jesus did something very profound to announce that he was the Messiah. Jesus chose a time when all of Jerusalem would be gathered in one place. He chose a place where crowds of people would see him, and he chose a way on the donkey that was going to be unmistakably a sign that he was their king. And when he did this, the crowd went wild. It was an epiphany moment. Yet there was a positioning on the outside. Yes, he positioned himself in a place, in a time and in a way. There was a greater positioning that was taking place right here. He was king. He was a king in his heart and he was a king in his mind. And in this moment, he had a destination in mind, and it wasn't a physical place or a physical destination. He was painting a picture right now of who he was on the inside. I'm your king. I'm the one that's going to save you. I'm the one that's going to save you in a way that you can't imagine and you can't fathom. What's on the inside of me speaks more than what's happening around me. There was something, a power on the inside of him that was resonating. It was an inner position that he took up in that moment to be the king of those people. And you see, all the imagery paints that picture. The fact that he came on a donkey, you know, just because he came in on a donkey doesn't mean that he was humble. You know, donkeys in those days were the animals of kings. In fact, he was riding in regal authority when he rode in on that donkey. And you see, kings in those days, if they were coming to combat or if they were coming to fight, they'd ride in on a stallion. But Jesus comes as the Prince of Peace because he's coming to redeem humanity, and he comes in a humility. And so all of this imagery is taking place. The palm branches, the Romans used to use those as a form of victory, and they would like crown their celebrated military events and things like that with palm leaves and palm branches. It was a sign of victory and triumph, and Jesus had an inner position of victory and triumph in that moment. You see, the inner position of Jesus emulated the physical position of Jesus in that moment. And you know, for some of us, there's a disparity between our inner position and our physical position, because we want the title, but we don't want the inner position. And so somebody who has an inner position of shame, they walk with a posture of shame. Their head is hung low, their eyes are down. If you are walking in strength, I mean, let me tell you, someone with strength on the inside of them and confidence, they strut. And there is a correlation between what's inside and what's outside. And some of us need to learn that the position of our heart and the posture of our heart and the posture of our spirit far supersedes anything else on the external. External, but the external will follow. And so in the next couple of days, we see Jesus step into a place in an authority realm of being a king that nobody had ever seen before. You see, there's the question I'd pose to you: who are you? Who are you really? Because Jesus was a king and everybody could see it and everybody could tell it. And there's an inward position that always comes first. See, position is the alignment required to reach my potential. Okay, so the third thing today is potential. Position is the alignment required to reach my potential. Touch somebody next to you and say, you can't do it alone. Oh, come on, you can do it better than that. Say, you can't do it alone. Give him a dead arm. You can't do it alone. I'm so violent, aren't I? Not really. Anyways, in Luke chapter 22, you can turn there in your Bibles. It's not going to be on the screen because I didn't tell them. I'm adding this in. It says that he walked away about a stone's throw. Don't you love the metric system of the Bible? About a stone's throw. And knelt down and prayed. Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. Then an angel from heaven appeared and strengthened him. Have you ever read that? I don't know why. I've always missed that portion. Never realized that Jesus would need strengthening. Then an angel of the Lord of heaven appeared and strengthened him. He prayed more fervently, and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like drops of blood. Jesus needed strengthening. Jesus needed to come to God and say, not my will, but your will. What we don't have is a picture of Jesus praising himself, putting perspective and praise out of perspective and saying, Jesus, you can do it. He's not playing, you know, what's that Rocky theme song? Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, the eye of the tiger, right? He's not eye of the tigering himself. He's not looking in the mirror going, you got this. You know, how do you talk yourself up? How do you get yourself into situations or a place of confidence? Jesus isn't looking for it inside himself. He doesn't have the strength that he needs in there. He needs to draw it from God. You see, when we look for strength within ourselves, that's self-help. That's positive talk. There's no power in that. And you see, Jesus had to be strengthened. You can't do it alone because Jesus couldn't do it alone. You see, in that moment, what does Jesus do? Jesus praises God. He says, not my will, but your will. Do you know what we do when we praise God? We say, God, help me. I don't know what I'm doing. Hosanna means God save. God save me. I can't do this on my own. I need you. And in that moment, we see that Jesus is aligned with God, and there is an allying that takes place. And what happens is it equips him to fulfill the potential on his life to be the savior of the world. It's such a powerful moment. You see, your praise finds its power in those moments. Your praise finds its power in not drawing strength from within, but drawing strength from without. And when you cry out to God and you say, God, I need you in my situation and I need you in my circumstance, he is more than willing to reach down and to pour his strength into you. Because that's the kind of God that we serve. And so right here, my whole perspective begins to shift around praise. You see, praise isn't about praising at the end when everything's done, the resurrection's happened, and oh, we celebrate now. No, the praise takes place at the beginning. The praise takes place at the beginning. No, I'm not gonna make my praise wait anymore for you, God. Everything's gonna shift right now. Oh, let me tell you, I'm gonna have my praise precede you moving. You see, there's a Psalm 150 verse 6. It says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Not everything that has breakthrough praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let me tell you, my praise is going to come not because of breakthrough, but because I have breath. Because I have breath. No matter the situation, no matter the circumstance, no matter what it is you're facing, you can praise your way through it. You can bring the strength of God into it with your praise. Your praise is powerful. Your praise is mighty. Your praise is what is going to get you out of your situation. Your praise is the thing that's going to set you free. Your praise needs to be the thing that prepares your perspective to rise above. Your praise is going to be the thing that determines the position of your heart. Your praise is going to be the thing that causes you to ally with God so that you can see him fulfill everything he purposed and planned for you to do.
We hope you were blessed by this message. If you have a story to share about what God has done in your life or what he's currently doing in your life, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at mystory@vivechurch.org. For more information, for service times and locations, or to partner with us financially, visit us at vivechurch.org.